and welcome the Honorable Mr. Justice B. Rajendran, and I thank him for readily accepting our invitation to give us a lecture on the Real Estate Regulatory Authority and its present situation. Honorable Mr. Justice B. Rajendran do not require much introduction to those who have practiced in High Court. He comes from a very illustrious family of lawyers hailing from Trichy. Thereafter, he shifted his practice from Trichy to Madras, and he also served as the government pleader's office for some time before adorning the post of the Honorable Judge. Then he served the Honorable High Court as a justice for a long time, and thereafter, at present, he is now serving as the chairman of Tamil Nadu Real Estate Appellate Tribunal. With this short introduction, I call upon the Honorable Judge to share his views on TN RERA Act. Thank you.
Good evening to one and all of you. I first of all thank Shivashanvam and other gentlemen who asked me to address this gathering. It's very nice to meet our friends, though not in person, in this COVID area by this virtual meeting. When Mr. Om Prakash and Shivashanvam came yesterday to discuss with us, I said, RERA being a new act, a special act, it has to be dealt in a special manner. No doubt, our good friends from the bar have yet to utilize the provisions of RERA. I assure you one thing, after this talk, after you go, you will understand there is a very good opening in the RERA forum. So let us start the understanding the act. I chose the topic, an overall view of the subject. I'm not going to deal section wise, but I'm going to deal the product in such a manner, how our advocates to deal with this act being a special act, and especially in the later part, I'm going to deal in regard to the COVID area, COVID period, how to go about under this act. Before also going to the act, you all know very well, it was long pending that people were suffering at large, mainly because the builder has not complied with the required promise made. I use the word promise made by the builder or the agent or any other person who has promised them to give their lifetime house, which didn't materialize to many of them. The dream was not to come true at all. Why? Because there was more number of persons coming into the field, more was offered, but not completed, not finalized. When this kind of era was going on, the then housing ministry decided to bring in a cumulative act, though at that point of time, Consumer Act was prevalent. A person who was deceived or not getting the proper response can go before the Consumer Court, yet to have a consolidated work on the act, this act was enacted. Now, the Government of India in the public gets notified on ensure the sale of a plot, apartment or building or sale of a real estate project in an efficient and transparent manner. Now comes the main thing in the object: protect the interest of the customers in the real estate sector. A establish an adjudicating mechanism for speedy dispute redressal, and then, of course, to establish an appellate tribunal to hear appeals from the decision or orders of the real estate authority and the adjudication officer. Now, very important thing is the object itself very clearly states that it is meant for the purpose of protecting the interest of the customers. But does it mean it only protects the interest of the home buyers alone? No. If you read the act fully, if you read the connotations, if you read the sections, if you give the various interpretations of the act itself, it denotes it can give benefit to both the home buyers, even the builders. Why I'm saying this is, a wrong notion has come into the mind that the act is only to deprive the interest of the builders. No. That's why I've always been calling every builder has to come under the RERA, because registration becomes mandatory. And if you register, you are safeguarded, and the customer, namely the buyer, is also very much safeguarded. In the later part of my discussion, I'll come to this subject in detail. Now, the salient feature of the act is, we'll have to now go to three important definitions. Section 2, of course, naturally defines all the details. Section 2E defines an apartment. The crux is that the space should be usable or to be used or intended to be used for residential or commercial activity. I am laying emphasis for the word, it should be a usable commodity. When we go to the definition under section 2J on the defines building, again, a specific mention is made in the act of any structure or erection or part of it which is intended to be used for residential or commercial or any business occupation, profession or trade, or for any other related purpose. The definition of the term building is inclusive in nature. Therefore, the importance is given to the end product, which is usable in nature. I was laying importance mainly on the word usable, because there are certain cases which we have come across, and we have also, of course, given a decision on that. And regarding the rules also, why the usable word is more important. What we have to understand is, under RERA, the ultimate aim of the act is to see the buyer gets a flat or a building which is in a usable nature, where he can go and occupy and have his residence. Since he is paying the full amount, the crux should be he must have an enjoyable nature of a building. That building does not building at all. It actually defines external development, which specifically even the execution of works in the periphery or outside, such as laying of roads, road systems, landscaping, water supply, sewage and drainage system, electricity supply, transformer, substation and soil waste management and disposal. Therefore, it contains everything which is useful nature of building. Apart from this, section 2Y defines garage. You have all a notion, the car parking which is given by the builders, whether it is an open car parking or a closed parking, whether it is called as a garage. But if you see the section in the act, garage has a different meaning. Garage does not mean open car park at all. Even a stilt car parking, where you have the roof but not the side, is not a garage, as contemplated in that. Because the word definition, garage means, which specifies having a roof and walls on three sides, can be called as a covered car park. It also specifies the definition of garage does not include open parking area. Therefore, when the act was contemplated, they wanted to give a complete picture, complete definition, complete inclusive in nature in respect of everything a customer needs or entitled to have it. And as far as the definition is concerned, only one more. 2ZK defines the promoter who comes under the era. ZN defines a real estate project, which includes building new apartments or converting an existing building or part thereof into apartments, or development of land into plots or apartments for the purpose of selling or coming into apartments or plots. Now, it also includes the common areas, the developmental works and all improvements and structures thereon, and all easementary rights appurtenance belonging thereto. That means section 2ZN categorically brings into nature that the building is in such a nature, it includes everything from the building to the end, ultimate end. Therefore, what is expected of a customer is the need which has to be fulfilled by the builder is to be in accordance with section 2ZN of the Act. Later on, I will come regarding the Act prevailing over the rule. Now, the main section to start with, where I is section 3. Section 3 deals with the registration. Registration is a mandatory for all the projects which are to be done. Only one condition. Before coming into the force of the Act, the building area should be more than 1,000 square meters, or it should have more than 8 apartments. Then they also the question, it is either or, which is also decided by the Appellate Tribunal. That case also, I'm going to deal with it. Now, the registration mandates three things, important things. Number one, nobody can even advertise or sell or propose to sell without registration after the coming into force of the Act. Without registration, promoter cannot even advertise, market, book, sell or offer for sale a real estate project or even a part of it. Now, registration, when is it mandatory, there are again two things. Registration of a project. A project may comprise of the number of different sectors, say A block, B block, C block, D block. They may register if they do it in a separately, division wise. Suppose he says only A block now, B block later on. He will have to register block wise, definitely. But at a later time, if he's starting later. But the point is, registration is mandatory after coming into the force of the Act. Now, section also deals with ongoing projects. Suppose during the coming into force of the Act, a project has already commenced. Project is on its way, whether it requires registration. The section offers two very important aspects on that. All ongoing projects meant for sale, where the area land are proposed, developed exceeds 500 square meters. Sorry, there was a mistake. Earlier I made 1,000 square meters. Or number of apartments to be developed exceeds 8 inclusive all phases have to register with RERA. Now, the ongoing project, at that point of time, there are 3 exemptions granted. It is a plot 1, only a plot. Plot has been authorized, layout plan has been approved. Prior to coming into the force, it is exempted. If it is contained, if a flat contained in the area of a CMDA, where the metropolitan area is concerned, where there is a completion certificate issue. You all know very well, a completion certificate is issued only after inspection by the CMDA in respect of the building, which is with the approved plan. In completion of the other works also, only then CMDA gives a completion certificate. If such a completion certificate has been issued in respect of a project prior to coming into the force of the Act, namely before 1/5/2017, such project, which is even though an ongoing project, which is not a completed project, which has not been over, it is exempted on the date if it is completion certificate is given. At the same time, if it is in the city CMDA area, it is outside what we call as the DTCP area, then certificate being issued, there is no provision for impression completion certificate. What they thought was, if a person has applied for completion certificate, if a person also person is asked for a, in the case of 2H3, in a, we only rule has defined it. So rule has defined it in the case of outside the area, after the notification of the rules, which was later on published, if somebody applies for the enumeration of them as a completed project, where according to the rules, structures, beams and columns have been erected, and the authority will go into the details, they may either reject it because completion is not perfect, or if they accept that the completion has been made, then they can issue a certificate and put it in the website as if the project is already completed on the date of coming into force of the Act. If such a certificate is issued, such a certificate is given by the DTCP, so enumerating them as coming to close in respect of the project, then they are exempted. Now I will take you to a very important fact. As we discussed in the section, in the definition of the section, what is required is a pakka, usable, habitable nature building, namely a plot or a flat. The rules came into force in Tamil Nadu on 22/6/2017. Rule 2H2 and Rule 2H3 define the difference in respect of the completion of the project. Of course, there is no dispute as far as CMDA area is concerned. Once the completion certificate is issued, automatically exempted. The problem arises in respect of the non-receipt area, the DTCP area, where the Act's rule defined that the building is deemed to be structurally completed when all the columns, beams, and slabs and submitted to the concerned local or the regional deputy within 15 days from the date of notification of the rules. This has been done probably 6 things which have completed to that extent at the coming into force of the Act. Now come to the point. There is an analogy. Anomaly, namely, the Act says 2ZN clearly defines that the building should be completed in all aspects. The rule says 2H3, which says if structure is complete. I will now define with a case, stage study. The first case came into in respect of Tamil Nadu was in respect of the case, I don't want to name the company, where they said they are going to build 16 floors, but prior to coming into the force, they applied to date on 2017. Within 15 days from the date of issue of the rule, stating now we are not putting up construction for the last 14, 15, 16 floor. We are now stopping it for 13. But they didn't say there. What they did was they applied for completion certificate. Sorry, they applied stating that it's an ongoing project which has been completed as it belongs to DTCP area without completing the third three floors. In other areas, of course, all the 13 floors, they said they have erected the columns, they have erected the structure, and nothing more left to be done. Therefore, they define it comes under the purview of the rule. And that day, there were many applications. They were also declared as an exempted category. Therefore, they said, we will not register under. One of the customer filed a petition under Section 3. This building, which has not been registered. Therefore, here note a point. Anybody can come. The registration has to be done by the promoter. But if the promoter fails to register the project, then including any person interested in that particular building and or the project, they can come before the Real Estate Regulation Authority and submit clearly that the person who have got to be registered has not registered. When such a complaint is lodged before the authority will give notice to the promoter as well as the home buyers association, if any, and then they will be given a hearing. A full-fledged inquiry will be conducted. In this case, an inquiry was conducted. The authority, before the authority, the main stand of the concerned company was, well, we don't know, we have not completed the topic fully well, which is not in a habitable nature. But I would come under the definition of 2H3, whereby it clearly indicates all the 13 floor stars, say construction has been over. The structure is completed. The four walls, the outer walls have been erected. The slabs have been constructed. The beams have been constructed. Therefore, we are exempted. The authority said no. This has to be in detail because you have not completed accordingly. Matter came before the tribunal. At the time, of course, the authority was not constituted. Only the secretary was the authority. So even then, he rejected it, against which the order came before the tribunal. The first case, the appeal number 1 of 2018, was decided by the tribunal, which is now available in the website. You can all go through it, where we dealt in a different angle. We said section, the act prevailed over the rules. When the act specifies a certain thing to be done in a certain manner, you cannot deviate by imposing a law in respect of a rule. When the rule cannot override this, especially when the ultimate project should have been completed in usable nature. Here, the project, even though 13 floors have constructed, What about the 14th and 15th and 16th floor? Only before the appellate tribunal, they came and filed an affidavit. We are not going to construct a 14th, 15th, 16th. As even the persons who are booked for 14th, 15th, 16th, we are ready to pay them back or allot them in the 13th floor, within the 13th floor. This is not the correct case where they can say, when the approved plan says 16 floors, they have not done so. Now, secondly, they have not completed the project. Therefore, they have categorically held that the project, even though the certificate has been issued, that it is a project completed, exempted, that was not accepted. We said no. And thereafter, we even went to the extent of saying, even in respect of a CMDA building, if for reasons best known, if after inspection, if on a verification, we come to understand that it has not been completed, still we will have our own assessment, and only then we come to a conclusion when the project is completely fulfilled. Take for instance another case where buildings were there, but there was a common phenomena is the both the buildings should be connected. The main, all other things are structurally completed. In fact, even indoors were completed. The one thing which is not completed is a building construction completion between the two buildings, and of course other amenities, including the swimming pool and various other amenities, which they said in the brochure that they are going to do it. And when they are not completed, we still said, you will not come under the exemption. You will have to go and register, because once you register, 3 points are raised. If they are answerable to RERA, they are commendable to the Act, they will be scrutinized by the association, they will come under the purview of the Act. Apart from that, the Act also provides for important thing. 70% of the total amount collected, if it is an ongoing, if it is a new project, has to be established in a new account, dedicated account. Only in that account, you will have to take the money and expenditure. Whereas in an ongoing project also, the remaining amount, which is due and payable on that day coming into force on registration, that has to be spent in accordance with the regulation. So a person, even though he has completed a certain portion, he will come under the ongoing project, has to go through these formalities, which is very, very important. This safeguard makes the Act very useful for the purpose of the home buyers. At the same time, it is also useful for the builder, because the builder is now sure his project will be completed. He is not diverting his funds. He is actually doing the work in accordance with the law, with the 70% amount accountable to that particular project. One important aspect again was raised. Can the builder take away all the 70% money deposited towards his purchase of the land? This is one moot question, still at a large, but normally he is not expected to take the entire money. That is why the first 30% is given, where he is expected to take the money, which may be the part or full of the land cost. That is why the authority, the Act, thought it fit to safeguard 70% of the total money, which is coming under the Act, from the purchases, will be deposited, safeguarded. Next important aspect which was raised, because I'm going not only by the as well as legal, which is we said, that question also is coming into question. An interesting question arose. The Act says, Section 3(2)(a), after the word 3(2)(a) says, either there should be exceed 500 square meters, or the number of proposed apartments to be developed does it inclusive of all phases. Word clearly used is inclusive of all phases. As I told earlier, the building can be raised in a phased manner. You can block by block, you can do it. Therefore, totally, he should not say, today I'm raising 4. Later on only I'm going to 4. But your entitlement is, totally he'll go. But an interesting lawyer took a very good point. He said, before the forum as well as the appellate tribunal, section 32A says, either or, therefore, it will also conjunctively read the act contemplating when there are two different things are given. The for exemption, it is not the either one. It should be having both. It should have exceed 500 square meters, and it is also exceeding 800 square meters, eight apartments. This was the argument there in a appeal number 70 of 2019. In a judgment rendered very recently on 22-5-2020, during the COVID breakup day, we have pronounced a judgment. Though we heard earlier in March, we rendered the judgment on this day. Because following a Supreme Court judgment, and there is a prior judgment in the Bombay tribunal also. There we have stated section 32A, after the to be developed does not inclusive all phases. In such circumstances, with the available materials as per section 32A, the developer's project 500 square meters. Hence, it comes under the purview of section 3. There we also pointed out, without disclosure of the facts on available materials, because they at the stage of the notice, at the stage of the authority, or at any other point of sale, they never estimated that they are stopping today or later on, how they are going to develop, what is the area, what is extent. But where we were able to, from the approved plan, when we are able to establish by the fact from the documents produced, the total when it exceeds 500 square meters, DRs, when they now say it's only 6 flats and not 8 flats, when the total exceeds in one extent, namely 500 square meters, it will come under the purview of the Act. Therefore, this is another important aspect which we dealt in respect of the implementation of the Act. Now, we are going to the Section 4. Section 4 is another important section regarding after the registration. It only specifically says how to apply for the real estate project in the registration. Section 4 gives the details, including the authentic copy of the approvals, commercial certificate. If you read, it gives all the details one by one, so that to specify that nothing is left over. In section class Z and D are very important. D specifically says the 70% amount to be realized for the project. So that is important, which is again doing very well in there. Now, very important point in section 4 is a proviso. Section proviso follows, provided also, second proviso, the promoter shall get his accounts audited within 6 months after the end of every financial year by a chartered accountant in practice, and shall produce a statement account duly certified by a chartered accountant, and shall be verified during the audit. Amounts collected for a particular have been utilized project. Soil has been in compliance with the promotion to the percentage of completion of the project. Stopping here for a moment. How best this word has been put in this act, in the act. What else is required to safeguard the interest of the public at large? Every bye which has been paid to the authority, to the builder, is accountable. It has to be audited, and RERA has got the right to inspect, verify, and then take necessary action for non-fulfillment of even doing this. Apart from that, they are also to file their 3 months. Authority can take including payment, including for payment of penalty, and ultimately, if they have not obeyed, even imprisonment could be ordered. So, the authority, the act has specifically catered to the needs of the public at large and specifically bringing into force so that the rights of the parties are safeguarded. 1 minute. Now, section 5 is grant registration. Whenever anybody applies, within 30 days, the registration has to be given even. Or if it complains, he has to do it. Now, advance all kinds of projects is now in itself. So that the parties need not even come to the office. I underline, nobody need to come to the office at all. All it requires is he can upload all the details which is required as per section 4. If it is stated, and payment of fees, which is also on e-payment, is available. Or you can also send a DD. Then registration will be scrutinized by the concerned authority, and registration normally within 3 days. So far, we have registered more than 1,800 projects before Corona. We are still about projects which are pending registration due to the Corona period lockdown. Otherwise, we have been uploading it, and the registration is immediately uploaded. If there is any difficulty, we call for them. So that is also done, and it is a valid for a period declaration given by them. During the registration, the promoter is to give up. That period, of course, we take into consideration, cannot be very unreasonable. And also, we also take into consideration the period up to which the license is granted. Take for instance, they would have applied earlier, before the coming into force of the act. After the coming into force, they are now seeking for registration. In the registration, he gives a specific clause which says, I would complete the project in a particular period. Though complete freedom is given to him, but the authority can also look into the question whether it is reasonable, whether it is within the limit, within the period of the actual available permit of the license period. Because in Tamil Nadu, you have an initial period of 5 years period for the building approval, and thereafter it extends automatically for 3 years on payment of fees. But at the same time, the structure of the building, the area of the building also has to be taken into consideration insofar as to the grant of the period of registration, because the registration is valid for a particular period. Now, next comes very important thing. Suppose if you are not able to complete the project within the time granted or within the time as you stated in the application, and if it expires, what will happen to the registration? No doubt, registration will be forfeited. But before that, is not there a remedy? Yes, there is a remedy under Section 6. Section 6 contemplated very clear what it says, that the registration granted under Section 5 may be extended by the authority on an application made by the promoter due to force majeure. In this COVID period, I'm going to include that. Force majeure in such form and on payment of such fees, provided that authority may, in reasonable circumstances, without default on the part of the promoter, based on the facts of each case, and for the extend the registration, of course, subject to condition of 1 year only. Now, force majeure also has been explained in the very section, in the explanation class, shall mean the case of war, flood, drought, fire, cyclone, earthquake, or any other caused by the nature affecting the fortunately, coronavirus is not, because we never, nobody expected this. If you see in many of the contracts, in government contracts, you will find all these clauses, but nobody ever thought of coronavirus. Now the question arises, what will happen during this coronavirus? Does it come under the force majeure case? I am happy to state that three states in India were the first one to state coronavirus will be taken into consideration as of, and even as early as 2020, Tamil Nadu stated that all projects which end as of 35-3-2020, which needs extension, shall be given automatic extension for 5 months. Bombay gave 3 months, Madhya Pradesh 5 months. Later on, the government of India itself has taken this into consideration, that because it will have to be another run of the section is for asking for even for the extension, every promoter has to apply. That means for us, it is 8,000, 15,000. Section 6, though, did not contemplate about force majeure, the virus case, COVID case. Tamil Nadu, Bombay, and Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, was the first one to state that COVID also will be taken care of in the force majeure, and all the projects which are to end by about 20th immediately came to the conclusion that the project which has been completed was not completed on or before 25-3 for 5 months in Tamil Nadu, 3 months in Bombay, Maharashtra, and 5 months in Madhya Pradesh. Later on, the government of India had issued a circular that in respect of all the projects where it is within the period, namely on or before 25-3-2020, the period will be automatically extended for a period of 6 months. It also gave a further discretion to all the authorities concerned in special circumstances, taking into consideration that particular area regarding the COVID or other benefits, then it can be extended for another 3 months. Therefore, totally 9 months period was given. Apart from this, second section also clearly says that for reasons best known, for reasons to be given, if a person is able to establish that there is a valid reason for extension, the authority has got the discretion to extend by 1 year. Therefore, in this COVID area, India has come to the rescue, not only for the builders, for everyone, bringing into understanding and consideration that this peculiar circumstances in our country can also be taken into account and necessary benefit could be given to them, including the extension. Thereafter, we have very important sections which deal with the India Act. Section 8, 7 and 8 go together. Revocation of registration and obligation authority consequent of lapse. Revocation will arise in respect of a default committed by the builder, and also promoter violates any of the terms or conditions of approval given by the competent authority, or if he is involved in any kind of unfair practice or irregularity. Here, another section, another important class is when he falsely represents that the service are of a particular standard or a grade, and then which has not been done, there also the authority can take necessary action. But what will happen to consequent to the cancellation of the registration? Was one moot point. Now you had heard of Amarpali case in the Supreme Court, where one of the best judgments which we have come across, where the RERA Act has been completely discussed. Amarpali buyers were given the benefit. The government, the Supreme Court itself interfered in that. They are asked to rebuild by the other association. Therefore, the power is vested under Section A to see that the project does not come to a standstill, where it can be done by the available method, including by the association of persons or by the registered persons or by any third party, as done by the Amarpali. In this connection, I will also bring to kind notice that the Supreme Court has categorically stated, if not only the association, anyone who is interested can come there and take up the project if the project is left over in the middle, and see that project could not be left alone, so that ultimately the buyer gets the benefit of the plant as such. Emphasis is given more on the project being completion. In this connection, I also bring to kind notice, the RERA itself was questioned originally before the Supreme Court, later it was transferred to Bombay High Court. Bombay High Court, in the famous case, the division bench of the Bombay High Court categorically held, Neelkamal relators were categorically discussed the every aspect of RERA, every section of RERA, how it has been upheld. Of course, a lot lengthy judgment I have gone through many times. I only request the lawyers kindly go through this one Neelkamal judgment, which will entitle you to bring the entire details of the RERA. Now, these are the first effects of the act, where the registration mandatory, where it is obligation on the fall to fulfill the points, and even if a registration is cancelled, how it has to be done. Then the second portion is regarding the agents. Agents, of course, you all know very well, earlier people used to give false promises. They are called, though at that point called brokers, later on we were calling it agents. They do a very good work. At the same time, some unscrupulous people were taking the people at large for a ride. To safeguard the interest, the act contemplates Section 9, where it is mandated every real estate agent has to register himself before dealing with the property, before dealing with the project, before canvassing, before selling to anyone. And the function, Section 10 deals with the functions of the real estate agent, how in maintain and preserve even books of accounts. He has also to be very careful that he cannot deal with a property which is not registered with RERA. If a project which is registrable under RERA, he must see that it is registered. He also is a person who can come to the RERA. A person who is not registered, he can bring to the notice. Earlier I stated about that. Now, it's a question of promoter's duties, liabilities, everything has been discussed in Section 11. One important factor in Section 11 is class, Section 4, Class F. Execute a registered conveyance deed of apartment, plot or building as the case may be, in favor of the allottee, along with the undivided proportional title in common to the association of allottees or capital as the case may be, as provided under Section 17. Because there's very important effect. In many of the cases, what we find is, after the completion, thereafter, they don't give the corpus fund, which has been received for many things, is not transferred to the association which is formed, nor the original title deeds handed over. Many other things happen. Therefore, the promoter's duty is defined under the Act, under Section 4F, insofar as to the registration of the property, registration of the undivided share, registration of the project, and also the payments which has to be made in accordance with the law. Section 12 is another important section where it says the obligation of a promoter regarding veracity of the advertisement or prospects. Many other cases which we come across is the prospects say one thing, but it is not being properly dealt with. They do not give as it is promised. Such cases can come under RERA. A person can complain before the authority. Very important thing. Earlier, you used to know, they used to get the agreement before even the agreement is signed. They used to take the money. Such advance amount is unheard of under the RERA Act before the agreement of sale. And the agreement of sale has to be registered now. And of course, Section 14 is sanctioned plan you have to follow. Here, an important thing arises under Section 14. Section 14 subclass 3. In fact, there is a moot question. What will happen to a project which has been completed earlier? Let us assume completion certificate given, completed prior to the coming into the force of the Act. Nothing can be done insofar as those projects where I will have no jurisdiction was a moot point which was in discussion. I came to know very well. Now, Section 14.3 is an answer to this. In case any structural defect or any other defect in workmanship, quality, or provision of services, or any other obligation of the promoter as per the agreement of sale relating to such development is brought to the notice of the promoter within a period of, highly emphasize, within a period of 5 years by the allottee from the date of handing over a possession. Very beautifully coined. Within 5 years from the date of handing over a possession. Let us assume it is. The project is completed in 2015. Act comes into force in 2017. We are now in 2020. Property was handed over in 2016. If there is a structural liability, can he not come to RERA within 5 years up to 2021? Even though it is not registered under RERA, at that point of time, it need not have been registered. There is no necessity for registration. Yet, if this clause clearly states that a person who has got a liability, who has got a grievance, who has got a structural disability, then still such projects can come under the property. Because we are yet to come across such a project. We have already come across certain things. In fact, Bombay Tribunal, in many of the cases, have categorically stated, dehors the registration. If there is a defect, then they can come to RERA. After all, it's a beneficial legislation. At another point, the section clearly says, Section 15, a promoter cannot transfer his right without the permission of 2/3 of the allottees. Because earlier you used to say, a person will start, he will abandon or he will sell it to third party without the consent of these persons, then he will come and demand more money. All those things are stopped now. If a promoter's interest has to be transferred, he needs to have 2/3 persons consent in writing or in a meeting agreed to transfer to the money. Then of course, transfer of title, all those things come into that. We have an important thing, Section 18. He said regarding to return of amount and compensation. If the promoter fails to complete or is unable to give possession of an apartment, plot or building in accordance with the terms of the agreement for sale, or as the case may be, duly completed by the dates specified therein, due to discontinuance of his business as a developer on account of suspension or revocation of the registration or for remuneration, he shall be liable on demand to the allottees in case of the allottee wishes to withdraw from the project without prejudice to any other remedy available to return the amount received by him in respect of that apartment, plot or building with the interest at such rate. Now, we have a very important section. If he fails to do this, he not only pays the return the amount, he is also liable to pay interest, and his authority has got the power to give cause under the act. We have, for this, we have an adjudicator. Section 71 deals with an adjudicator. Who is a district judge? Who is a district judge appointed? Power to adjudicate is Section 71. He is a retired judge who is appointed, who takes care of all these angles. You will come across many cases which we come here, which go before the authority. Then it is given to the adjudicator, who in turn takes, it literally conducts the case as that of a civil court. Then he passes an order, because against his order, there is an appeal which comes to the authority. In that order, he will order direction of returning the amount. He will also give interest. He will also give compensation. All these three is available. Now comes the effective portion. What will happen if he doesn't pay? Yes, EP is provided. But one anomaly in this whole act is, if it is an order passed by the authority, litigation officer, then it is to be treated as a revenue recovery, recoverable under the Revenue Recovery Act. It can be transmitted to the collector. But if it is not paid, even the criminal proceedings can be taken note of. It can be directed for imprisonment. But one anomaly which we find under the act is, if you take the Consumer Protection Act, in the Consumer Protection Act, Section 23 contemplates the power of the magistrate is given to the given under the act itself. Therefore, the authority himself can act as a magistrate, whereas that power has not been given. We have also sought for an amendment, but definitely the power to invoke even criminal proceedings is very much available under the act, though we fought it to be on the safer side. Amendment is also to be carried out. There are even certain anomalies which we are trying to work out in a major case. You may ask a question. Under the act, the civil proceedings, civil court has been eliminated. What will happen if an agreement is containing an arbitration clause? The tribunal, in the latest judgment, we have categorically held arbitration clause in an agreement between a builder and a buyer, whether before registration, before the RERA came into force, or after that, will not disentitle the person from coming to RERA. In view of the latest judgment of the Supreme Court, 2019, 12 SEC, page 721, which clearly says the act is a special enactment. When a special provision is given, therefore, he cannot continue to say that you are come under that. I think I'm exceeding the time limit. I'll consider compliant with another 2 points, though there is a lot to say. As I said, it's a new act, it's a new horizon. It can have many things to come. But then, what we say is, the act provides for everything. Act provides for the supervision of the authority in respect of the stage-wise construction, in respect of the stage-wise utilization of the fund, in respect of the period in which the construction is over, the quality of construction, all this, it has a supervisory power, it has an advisory power, it has, we can even recommend to the government in regard to certain factors, and it has got a judicial power. All these things are coupled in this act to safeguard the interest, and section 19 deals with the rights of the allottees. Of course, section 20 and above deals with the formation of the tribunal and formation of the appellate tribunal, powers of the tribunal, all those things are dealt in detail. Section 59 is another important section. I emphasize this F59 because punishment for non-registration. What will happen if a person does not register? If any promoter does not comply with the orders, decision or direction issued under section 1 or continues to violate the provision of section 3, he shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 3 years, or with fine which may extend up to a further 10% of the estimated cost of the real estate project. Mind you, the tribunal and the authority has got the power to pay a direct compensation to be paid, not an ordinary compensation. 10 times the cost of the project can be given. Imagine a project of 100 crores, the cost can be 10 crores, and also 3 years imprisonment. To this extent they have given. And similarly for penalty 60, penalty for contravention, that is for giving a false information, he shall be liable to a penalty which may be extended to 5% of the estimated cost of the real estate project as the authority. So every provision, there is a penalty clause provided in section 59 to section 70. Of course, 70, there is one provision, compounding of open solve. As I said, of course, with very great difficulty due to their technical difficulty, the act has done very well. And one judgment, latest judgment of the Supreme Court in respect to the Pioneer Homes, where regarding the IBC, the coming into force of the act, both the parties can approach consumer court, they can approach the IBC, they can approach RERA. Because RERA, this is a specific clause, you have already approached, you have to come after seeking permission from that court. Of course, Supreme Court has lately said, the prerogative is on the party which is there. Therefore, these are the three latest judgments. They have taken long time due to the power disconnection. There has been some trouble. Of course, I would like to answer any questions subject to your time, please.
Sir, thank you very much, sir. It was a wonderful session, but unfortunately, technology has played a spoil sport today. It is actually not a big time, sir. Normally, we have 1.5 hours, 2 hour sessions also. We were looking forward on a very interesting subject because more than 100 participants were also there throughout the session. We will only request that some other day we will have like to have at least one interactive and question answer session, sir. This time, we will ensure that things are in order.
Very good.
We apologize, sir, on our behalf that we also gave you a lot of trouble.
Not at all.
This time,
not at all.
We will ensure that we will have a better connectivity issues sorted out, sir.
It was my pleasure to meet everyone. And I once again say to all the audiences for the inconvenience caused, but definitely we will have one more interactive session. This act is a very big one. It calls for a dialogue, open dialogue. Kindly, before that, I would also only say one thing.
Sir, there are 1 or 2 the questions which are coming up. Can I ask it, sir?
Please.
Sir, one of the participants, Mr. T.R. Sendul Kumar, wants to know, in case of failure on the part of purchaser, is it any percentage prescribed in RERA?
Well, wonderful question. I said in the beginning itself, if the purchaser does not pay the money, the builder also can come to RERA. He can come to say he has not paid the money. In fact, in one of the case, latest case, if you see in the judge, and then he has brought He did not pay 9,21,000. But him for some deposit was due court.
Instead of prolonging this, I propose that we end this session. We sincerely apologize for all the inconvenience caused to all participants. We will again get back to justice and we will see, we will at the earliest have a special interactive session with question answers alone on RERA. Since you already got a bird's eye view of the enactment, I think our participants can also come prepared on any questions which you want to be clarified, any issues which you would like to have been more explained.
Sir, Lordships has joined.
Yes.
Yeah. Anyway, I should thank you all very much for the nice way you have done that. I'm ready for the next session. We will exclusively we'll have for the question and answers.
Yes. We will organize at the earliest, sir. Thank you very much. So again, once again, sorry okay. for the difficulty and inconvenience caused.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all. Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure. Thank you. Thank you.